prophet. John the Baptist was a prophet. Jesus was the Son of God. He was God with us, more than just a prophet. Our fathers worship in this mountain, and ye say that in Jerusalem is the place where men ought to worship. And Jesus said unto her, Woman, believe me, the hour cometh when ye shall neither in this mountain nor at Jerusalem worship the Father. Ye worship, ye know not what. It says you don't know what you're worshiping. We know what we worship, for salvation is of the Jews. But the hour cometh, and now is, when the true worshipers shall worship the Father in spirit and in truth. For the Father seeketh such to worship him. God is a spirit, and they that worship him must worship him in spirit and in truth. There's a lot of people that worship the Lord, but they know not what they worship. They worship the Lord, but they live antichrist. There's a time in the Old Testament when the children of Israel were shouting and worshiping, and they were tithing and giving, and they were living like the devil. And God said, take this noise away from me. Their worship had become a noise rather than a sweet sound because of the life that they were living. Their hands were dirty. Their hearts were impure. Their motives were self-centered. Spirit in spirit and in truth means that there are no physical barriers between you and God. When God's dealing with you on something and you refuse to change and you callous it over and you act like he hasn't said anything, he said something.
That voice you heard?
When we callous over the things that we do wrong and imagine them away and then imagine God doesn't see and continue to pursue God, the Lord is looking for hearts that are right through him and by him and only through him. Because forgiveness, it only comes from God. And if anybody's going to operate in that living water, it only comes from God. It doesn't come from anywhere else. There's no other name in heaven or in earth by which men can be saved and cleansed and forgiven. And that's where we need to operate. And sometimes we have to, as individuals, go back and do our first works over again. Sometimes we get off track. And it's tough. It's tough to admit when we make mistakes. Sometimes the farther we get along, the harder it is to make, admit that we've made a mistake. But I'm going to tell you, kind of like a ship. If a ship is just a degree off course, it's not going to reach where it was intended to reach. And it's going to find itself in a land it's unfamiliar with and needing to get back on track.
Right.
That's where repentance comes in. That's where John's words in the letters come and say, my little children, I write these things unto you that you sin not. I don't want you to sin. If it does happen, there's a way that you can get back on track. There's an advocate with the Father. And he can help you get back on track. Repentance and godly sorrow works a wonderful work. And the woman said unto him, I know that Messiah cometh, which is called Christ. Apparently she was reading the scripture too, huh? You mean Samaritans could read the Bible? I guess they could, the Old Testament. And when he is come, he will tell us all things. And Jesus said unto her, I that speak unto thee am he. Yeah. Yeah. Now, listen, this didn't bowl her over in the physical like it did when the Romans came to get him. The Romans came against him without understanding. She came to him with understanding. Oh, man, this is good now. Listen.
Right.
Listen, the Romans came without understanding, and sure. They said, we're looking for the Christ. And he says, I am he. And they, grown men with swords and spears, they fall back on the ground at his word. This woman says, I know that there's a Messiah coming and that the Christ is coming. And Jesus says, I am he. And she receives it.
Right.
It's like it penetrates to the core of her being. And then she runs off the missionary.
Right. Yeah.
Instead of the misfit. In one encounter with Christ, it changes her life. And she understands who he is, that he is. And it says, upon this, the disciples came and marveled that he talked to a woman. His disciples didn't understand. Yet no man said, what seekest thou? Why talkest with her? Nobody questioned what he was doing. Okay. And the woman left her water pot. She left the physical and went her way into the city and saith to the men. Who she talked to? The men. Come and see a man which told me all things that ever I did. Is this not the Christ? And they went out of the city and came to him.
That's cool.
Woo! In the meanwhile, his disciples prayed him, Master, eat. But he said, I have meat that ye know not of. My meat is to do the will of him that sent me and to finish his work. Say not, yet there are 4 months, and then cometh the harvest. Behold, I say unto you, lift up your eyes and look on the harvest, for the fields are white already to harvest. And he that reapeth receiveth wages, and he that gathereth fruit unto eternal life, that both he that soweth and he that reapeth may rejoice together. And herein is that saying, one soweth, another reapeth. I sent you to reap that whereon ye bestowed no labor. Other men labored, and ye are entered into their labors. Now listen, this is good stuff. There's a lot that we could say about that. I think this would be a good point to break and to come back at it next week. And I appreciate your attention tonight. This really gets into the some plant and some water, but God gives the increase. Now, I want to tell you, I mentioned Sunday night how that no church came to rescue me and Sister Shelley out of a life of sin. The Spirit of God called to us, and it was because of church in my early life. And it's just Shelley's testimony. She'll tell you that when we knelt beside the bed that night, she didn't know how to pray as a grown person. She didn't know how to pray. And she began to repeat the things that I would pray, but for herself. And it was a wonderful thing. But someone had planted seeds in my life before the age of 11 that came to fruition in my 20s.
Right.
Some plant, some water, and God gives the increase. Praise the Lord.